If you're a regular viewer, you've probably seen the work of David Ruck, who has shot and produced a number of segments for us over the years. In this next segment, David steps out from behind the camera to tell you about a new high-tech effort to map the bottom of the lakes.
NOAA's survey vessel, the Thomas Jefferson, is a purpose-built survey machine. And the last time a vessel of this capability graced the Great Lakes was around four decades ago. The Jefferson, along with a flotilla of other craft, are charting the details of the Great Lakes bottomlands in unprecedented detail. It's all part of an effort to update navigational charts used by mariners across the region, a priority of NOAA's Office of Coast Survey. Today, the Jefferson is charting areas around Cleveland, called approaches, critical to navigation in the Great Lakes economy.
Gotta get your sea legs ready. It's a little choppy out there today.
Patrick Osborne captains one of the small vessels, or launches, attached to the Thomas Jefferson, also called the TJ. Today it's my water taxi, but it's usually used to conduct sonar surveys of the lake bottom.
Hydrographic Survey is taking technology and mapping the bottom of the ocean floor to get appropriate or proper depths so that ships can pass without causing damage to their vessels. This launch gives us the capability to push further inshore to conduct hydrographic survey operations away from our larger ship.
We're gonna pull up alongside it, and they're gonna latch into the boat that we're on and actually pull us up into the air and onto the deck of the boat.
Hook it up!
Commander Matthew Jaskowski of the NOAA Corps leads a crew of around 30 aboard the Jefferson.
Ocean mapping is our main primary goal. We're updating the nautical charts, the maps that the mariners use to navigate from one port to the other.
What's different about those in terms of the technology that was used to make those maps versus what you're doing today?
The data that we used to make those maps are quite old, and it's a question of resolution.
While current navigational charts of the Great Lakes have aided navigation for decades, they're based on a patchwork of data gathered using primitive survey methods, like lead line surveys, in some cases around 80 years ago, indicating only depths, often miles apart. The data gathered by the Thomas Jefferson represents a giant leap forward in resolution. Sonar and advanced computing will create charts that are both internationally standardized and highly detailed. Erin Siraki is the chief survey technician aboard the Thomas Jefferson. Her team ensures that the data they collect is clear and accurate. And to do that, they rely on two main pieces of survey equipment.
So we are currently on the main deck of the ship, underneath one of our hydrographic survey launches. In this black mounting box, we have the multi-beam sonar. That one is the one that's actually giving us the soundings that we put on the chart, how deep the water is. And then beside it, the long torpedo shape, that is our side scan sonar, but it gives us very high resolution imagery of any different seafloor types, any wrecks, obstructions, or other points of interest on the bottom.
The equipment that's on here, maybe the scale is a little bit different, but it's pretty much the same as what's on the Thomas Jefferson itself.
So actually the multi-beam system, it is identical. So we have that same exact setup in the hull of the ship, but we also have a second multi-beam system that is much, much larger on the ship. It just works at a different frequency.
While the side-scan sonar on the launches is attached to their hull, the TJ uses a different configuration, and it looks like a torpedo, but it's actually called a towfish.
So this is not a weapon.
This is not a weapon, even though it looks like one. This is our ship side-scan, just a lot bigger. This is the one that gives us the high-resolution imagery of the seafloor. So we deploy this off the back of the ship in its tow point. And then we have a control in the survey station to control the winch. We let cable out to get it down to depth, and then we can bring cable in to bring it up.
Water temperature greatly impacts the way sound travels through the water column. And if it's not taken into account, the returns from the sonar can give misleading results. To overcome this, the ship uses what's called a moving vessel profiler, or MVP, which captures the range of temperatures between the hull of the ship and the bottom. This information is vital to getting a clear picture of the bottom of the lake. By factoring in the temperature profile of the water column, the survey team can adjust and correct the vision of the multi-beam sonar, almost like a mathematical pair of prescription glasses. At the heart of the Thomas Jefferson is its acquisition station, where all of the sonar data comes to life on a series of displays in real time. One monitor shows the readings from the multi-beam sonar.
So this is the track of our vessel. The color that you see on either side is the actual swath from the multi-beam. This is what they refer to as a seabed image, essentially a backscatter image, intensity of return. And then this is more of like a three-dimensional view.
Another monitor shows the image from the side scan, which is so detailed it almost looks like a photograph.
It's looking out to either side in kind of this like wide triangle pattern.
Uh-huh.
Right now you've got a bird's eye view.
Surveys 80 years ago would give us a general sense of the depth of the lake, but these high-definition sonar surveys are even giving us snapshots of the lake's history.
And it looks like, in this case, there's some sort of feature.
Yes, yep. I mean, it's pretty obvious that it's a wreck of some kind.
Lake Erie had the Battle of Lake Erie.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys are going to be doing some work in areas where stuff like that took place. Is there a chance that the information that you're collecting could help solve some questions about the way the Battle of Lake Erie unfolded?
Sure it could. How and where and to whom that information gets released is up to the historical preservation societies.
All of this information is passed through NOAA's hydrographic branch before it becomes public. That process begins with Peter Holmberg, a physical scientist with NOAA, who's reviewing information gathered by Aaron's team. He brought something strange up on the screen that he wanted me to see.
You've brought something up on the screen here that you wouldn't necessarily expect to find at the bottom of one of the Great Lakes.
A couple people have seen these before me, and I saw more of them last night. These 18-meter diameter rings. I drew a subset over it, and so over in the other window here in Subset Editor, you can see it in 3D. It's maybe sticking up about a tenth to two-tenths of a meter. So it's certainly not anything that's a hazard to navigation, which is good, but it is really curious.
Curious indeed, and it could end up being more than just a curiosity. On a survey in Lake Huron in the early 2000s, researchers discovered sinkholes peppered around Thunder Bay National Marine Sanctuary. Further exploration revealed these wild environments had their own chemistry and were home to ancient life forms like purple and white cyanobacteria. The sinkholes are helping scientists learn what Earth was like billions of years ago, and teaching us what we might look for as we explore Jupiter's moon, Europa. What we learned from the Great Lakes could inform how we explore space. Could these mysterious rings be another discovery like that? Only time will tell.
You're updating those charts,
mm-hmm.
but then occasionally, along the way, you come across a shipwreck.
Yes.
You come across something like this.
Right.
It sounds like there's a lot of mystery even to something as seemingly benign as the bottom of the Great Lakes.
Yeah, there is a lot of mystery to it.
The Great Lakes, only about 5 to 15% of the lake bed has been mapped to modern standards. The nature of the work that we're doing reaches far beyond just safety and navigation. The data that we're collecting has a lot of other uses, from habitat mapping, natural resource protection or management of exploitation, coastal development, coastal ecosystem management. There's a lot of different uses for this, and one of the biggest things that we get out of this is that the Great Lakes are big, they're deep. We don't know what we're going to find when we start poking around with these high-resolution sonars, and that's one of the more exciting things about this is that the things that you don't know tend to be the most exciting things to learn later on.
I, for one, can't wait to see what's discovered along the way.
Thanks for watching. For more on these stories and the Great Lakes in general, visit greatlakesnow.org. When you get there, you can follow us on social media or subscribe to our newsletter to get updates about our work. See you out on the lakes.